need to understand who has prolonged this fever. The reason why I say this, many times we prolong the fever by doing something that is not very right. And therefore, we will discuss the issue as we see in clinical practice. Many of these are defined in the classical standard textbook. There is some kind of definition. And I don't think in clinical practice you go by those definitions at all. Therefore, we will skip the scientific part of the definition. Don't feel I'm talking unscientific things here. But I will restrict the next slide, please. A prolonged fever to a clinician is persistence of fever beyond anticipated period. So, the problem of anticipation comes only if you know what you are treating. And most of us don't know what's the cause of fever. So you can imagine most of us do not know what is anticipated. We only hope he gets better. And if he doesn't, then you call him a prolonged fever. And therefore, this kind of a prolonged fever, to me as a clinician, has no clear definition. If somebody has, say, a systemic vasculitis, okay, which is likely to run a fever of even 3-4 weeks as anticipated, then I don't call it as a prolonged fever, provided I know what I'm treating. This is mostly a result of undiagnosed condition and partial treatment. And I think this is very common in the clinical practice. I strongly believe, and I practice that way, that in the first 2 or 3 days of fever, I hardly find a cause clinically. Therefore, when I give a talk on pyrexia of unknown origin, I feel every pyrexia in the first 3 days is of unknown origin. And even then, most of us treat with some kind of an antibiotic or some. And I think therefore, the undiagnosed condition partially treated is worse. It may be safe if you gave a viral infection an antibiotic, because at least it won't change the course of illness, though your intervention is wrong. But if you gave an antibiotic to a bacterial infection without knowing which bacterial infection and in which part of the body, then I think you run a very high risk of prolonging the illness in some form or another. And therefore, to me, the message of this statement is that please diagnose the cause of fever before even you treat, because that itself is likely to cause a prolonged illness, often with prolonged fever. The fear in the mind of a clinician is that if I don't treat, he would get worse. But the fear should be, if I treat wrongly, he would be worse than worse. And I think that should be clear. My message on this is that if you see a child with 2 or 3 days of fever without a localization and you don't know the cause clinically, you need to be only sure that he will not die because of your delay in diagnosis. And there is no hurry to treat him if you are sure that he will not be a risk to a worsening situation. And what can worsen in terms of fever? To me, only few things. I need to be sure he has no meningitis. I need to be sure he has no pneumonia. I need to be sure he has no diphtheria, though probably that's getting much less frequently seen now. I need to be sure he has no sepsis and a thin lesion like a purpuric spot. Otherwise, he could be in trouble. He may have a meningococcemia, for example. And he should not have a surgical abdomen waiting to burst and get into trouble. I don't think there is a sixth condition which can be fatal if you don't diagnose in a hurry. So all that I want each one of us to do in the first 3 days of fever is to see that he is fully conscious, he has no meningeal signs, he has no Bobby Fontenelle. He is not tachypneic, his ELISA is not working, his chest is not retracting. So that's pneumonia. Look at the skin and confirm he has no skin rash that might represent purpura and a meningococcemia or sepsis. Look at his peripheral perfusion, look at his nail bed, and see his capillary refill and say he's all right. Look at his throat well and be sure he has no membrane there. And look at his abdomen, there is no guarding rigidity, tenderness. This fellow won't die even if you do nothing. And I think if that is the concept, then many prolonged fevers will not be prolonged or will not be complicated. And I don't think you lose a typhoid because you didn't start an antibiotic on day 1. I don't think you lose a urinary tract infection because you didn't diagnose it on day one. But you lose him because you started some amoxicillin without knowing that he had a UTI. And I think that's much more dangerous. The problem with clinician is that error of commission is acceptable, error of omission is not. But this is not an error at all. If I tell a patient that 3 days of fever, that I can't find what is wrong with you, but I know that there is nothing wrong that can put you into trouble, I think you will wait. And in the next day or two, either clinically or with proper investigation, I can diagnose it correctly and not partially treat. It is not rare to see a prolonged fever with brain abscesses because somebody is treating without knowing meningitis, some haphazard oral antibiotic, or a UTI recurrently coming with fever and coming with the renal damage and so on and so forth. And I think that's the cause. At times due to misdiagnosed condition. You have a viral positive, so you have a typhoid. I'm sure yesterday you had a lot of discussion on lab tests, and we must have known and learned that lab tests are not directly related, especially when it comes to serology or such undifferentiated tests. You are not talking about bacteriology. Even there, a commensal, a contaminant and so on are still the issues. But a serological basis of diagnosis may not be the right one. And in the clinical context, for example, I always tell the parents of my patients that if you came running to me in a panic and said, look, what happened? Why are you coming running to me? No, sir, my x-ray of the leg shows a crack fracture. But I said, I'm seeing you running to me. What's the problem? He said, no, but the x-ray shows that. I said, you plaster an x-ray, don't plaster your leg. So the point is the clinician should not lose his perspective. And many times the misdiagnosed condition, sir, I'm treating typhoid, I've changed from amoxicillin to ceftriaxone to ciprofloxacin, and still he's not all right. I think what is not all right is he's no typhoid at all. How can he be all right? Nothing was right. And therefore a misdiagnosed condition. But rarely, and that is rare, in spite of the correct diagnosis and correct treatment, the fever continues. Now that is not iatrogenic. And therefore, we will discuss in the next 15 minutes issues that come out of largely our own doing and sometimes the nature's doing, though rarely. And therefore, mostly we are responsible. Sometimes it is bad luck, the nature, the course of events, and we will see how we go about it. The next one, please. What is the basic approach of any fever? If I said that prolongation of fever is often caused and contributed by us, let's look at the basic approach to any fever first and see how we may avoid prolongation of fever, at least an undue prolongation of fever. The basic approach to any disease, in fact, fever is just a discussion in question today, is that you must first diagnose anatomy. Unless you know where is the disease, how can you know what is the disease and what's the cause of the disease? That's far off. Imagine our forefathers who started teaching anatomy in the first year, and a physiology and a pathology then, and pharmacology, and then a clinical medicine. He has a run of sequence, as if to say that you won't know pathology unless you knew physiology, and pathology is a disturbed physiology. You ought to know what is physiology, and then you know what is disturbed to call it pathology. And therefore, a clinician must give an anatomical diagnosis. Suppose there is a sudden noise here in this place, we must know from where the noise came. Suppose the noise came from that bulb there, then it must be some electrical problem. But if the noise came from outside the hall somewhere with humans fighting, then it must be a different etiology. Anatomy becomes very, very important. But in many fevers, there is no localization to decide where is the anatomy. Fever is the only symptom. If you had a cough, you know it's a respiratory tract. If it's a diarrhea, vomiting, etc., you know it may be a GI tract or whatever. Of course, in small babies, they have many symptoms which are even unrelated. Who doesn't vomit? Every sick baby vomits. More so if the mother forces to eat and further forces the medication down the throat. And the mother says, oh yes, he vomited also. And you say, oh, vomiting? And you say, what about irritability? Yes, irritability. And fever, so fever, headache, vomiting must be meningitis. So the small babies do all kinds of things. You have an otitis media and there is a loose stool there. The parenteral infection. But those loose stools are not abnormal stools flowing out It's just a thing. Haven't we seen an appendicitis coming with first day, one loose stool? You say, oh, one loose stool, you have a diarrhea, dysentery, don't worry. Get the stool checked. But his pain is out of proportion, his toxicity is guarding, his rigidity, and you know that his loose stool is a sympathetic reaction, as if to say, oh, you are sick, I will also show, I am also worried. Intestines also pass one loose stool, it's really an appendicitis. So sometimes the anatomical diagnosis is not easy, especially in fever which has no localization. If you do not know anatomy, pathology is further difficult to know. And what's pathology? The same terms that we use in our undergraduate days. And here, related to fever, every fever we must think whether is it inflammatory or non-inflammatory. At least the basic difference between inflammatory fevers and non-inflammatory fevers can be attempted by a clinician. And then comes the etiology. If it's an inflammation, as is the common cause of fever, then is it infection or no infection? And if it's infection, of course, is it bacterial, viral, parasitic, etc.? Are there rheumatic disorders with fever which are inflammatory, non-infective? Or it may be a malignancy, or it may be even a central fever which are not even inflammatory, or it may be a hormonal problem like say thyrotoxicosis with fever. The point I'm making is that let's analyze fever anatomically, pathologically and etiologically in sequence if possible. But many times in fever anatomy is not known because there is only one symptom, fever. And if that is so, knowing further the pathology and etiology is even more difficult, in which case I make sure that it is not a serious fatal condition likely to be, and I stay put till the anatomy, pathology and etiology evolves either by clinical progression or by the laboratory test. The next one, please. Having given this background, let me say, when you have a fever without localization and therefore you even don't know the anatomy, how you will progress further to be sure that I am not going to be on a prolonged fever situation. So what is the special emphasis? These things are not often picked up by a clinician in the history or not told by the parents, volunteers, unless we ask for it. We must find out whether this child has a skin rash. Many skin rashes are evanescent. The child comes with a fever for 4 days or 8 days or 2 weeks, whatever. And unless you ask the mother, what about skin rash? Do you think in these 2 weeks there was a skin rash any time? Many mothers on direct questioning might say, yes, I think so. That there have been times when there was a skin rash, but that rash disappeared. The mother was not impressed by even reporting that skin rash. But when you ask about skin rash, she says, yeah, I did find sometimes, some days there was a rash, but then it disappeared, so I didn't worry. Bony pains, arthralgia, for example, mouth ulcers, myalgia, at present or even in the past. Some of the symptoms may be sequential, that you may not have them today, but you had them yesterday or last week, and they represent the same illness. And to that extent, or did your child have any of these in the last 2 weeks that you were coming with fever to me, that it may not be there right now. And because it's not there right now, the parents say, oh, why to report a mouth ulcer? It was there, but it is not there now. I think let's not confuse the doctor with something which has disappeared. And that's exactly the cue for a doctor, that, oh, there were some mouth ulcers too. Is it related to my prolonged fever? And I think that's where it is. The next thing is a circumstantial probability, which means, is this host a vulnerable host? Is he a newborn? Is he a small infant? Is he a malnourished infant? Is he a non-immunized infant or a child? Or epidemiology. Just now I learned that just 150 kilometers away from Chennai, there is hardly any malaria, I was told. In Chennai, I'm told a lot of leptospirals. So somebody who comes from Chennai there to Mumbai, I need to keep in mind the epidemiology from various comes, and of course the contact. When it comes to a TB, we are all impressed by contact. And I'm sure undergraduate also is trained, ask for TB contact. Unfortunately, undergraduate, when he asks for a TB contact, he tells me, sir, this child has a TB contact. I said, who was that? His grandfather died 80 years ago with TB. That's no contact. That's a genetic contact now. But so the contact has to be further elaborated in real contact. Okay. But when it is any other illness, we don't take into consideration contact. The commonest contact that we see in clinical practice is a viral infection. And I feel as a clinician, if two children are suffering from the same disease of fever, it's a virus killed otherwise. You don't see two pneumonias, two malarias, two UTIs, two tonsillitis, two appendicitis, one after another, rarely. But you see viral infections galore. Moment you ask, anybody else around now or last week having a similar disease? Oh yes, doctor, I had it first, then my wife had it, then my child had it. Why are you investigating him? He has a viral infection killed otherwise. So contact may become fine. Antibiotic response. This may be a good question to ask. That what happened? Of course, today it is nice to know that crocin doesn't work. So, don't use nice. Nothing against a brand. But what we are interested in is an antibiotic response. When you give paracetamol, what's the response? Oh, doctor, it doesn't work. It doesn't work not because it has failed. The infection is such that it doesn't work. And therefore there is no need to crash down fever. Gone are the days when our teachers taught us remittent fever, continuous fever, intermittent fever. Soon thereafter our teachers realized that these boys are terrible. They don't allow any fever to be continuous. Everyone is remittent, if possible intermittent. Thanks to our medication, paracetamol, ibuprofen, ibuprofen plus paracetamol, something to go with metoclopramide so that it's absorbed better, and if not, the most powerful antibiotic, that any fever will come down even if the child dies of the same infection. So there is antibiotic response, and I think the best response is seen when you give a drug which generally works. So to me, a paracetamol response. And if a patient says, doctor, I give paracetamol, not even a bit of a response, I understand that the body's immune mechanism is fighting a severe enemy. And that's why he's not showing a response. Of course, one reason why there is no response at all is a central fever. Suppose he has a hypothalamic damage and he's having fever, a neurological cause of fever, characterized by no response to an antibiotic at all. But look at the malaria. Doctor, I give paracetamol, no response. But God knows what happened. Afterwards, he's all right. Nature is showing you what it is doing. And therefore, an antibiotic response often gives you a clue. It is not an isolated syndrome that you pick up and say, oh, if it's intermittent, it is this diagnosis, continuous as this. But put all together, each one of these points gets a clinician something more important that today's clinician may be missing just because he's after getting the fever down. I think fever is never an emergency, mostly, unless it's hyperpyrexia, which is rare in the community. Other drugs used, history is very important, and it's unfortunate that today I don't see any prolonged fever where every drug has been used, and even then it is prolonged. So it is called prolonged fever. An average pediatrician would phone me to say, sir, I need your help because I have a child of fever who is going on for the last 3 weeks. I said, what have you done? He doesn't say what has he been diagnosed, he says what he has done. So I started with amoxicillin. When it did not improve, I tried ciprofloxacin, and then cefotrim is also tried. Ceftriaxone I tried. I think I should give anti-TB drug. What do you think? Yeah. It is a classical syndrome. All of us have. It's not that I don't have or you have. But I think at that stage, nobody can answer a question. Okay. And the best answer is, now stop everything. Because why, after doing many things, if you have not understood, you might understand not doing anything better. And therefore, other drugs used, and then of course the personal history judged progress. If I see a child with 3 weeks of fever, prolonged fever, but I say, what's wrong otherwise? And therefore it's very important to be an undergraduate first, even when you are a postgraduate. Because there is no replacement for a sequence and a pattern of the history taking and all that we have gone through. That many times, a personal history, family history, diet history, nutrition history, birth history, everything is very, very important. I know when it's personal history to an undergraduate, personal history, urination, day and night, bowel pattern. Each one may have something to tell you. For example, if you see a 3 and 4 weeks old, it may not be coming forth unless you ask a leading question. And same way on examination, we will do head-to-toe a detailed examination, but a special emphasis when I have no clue on assess seriousness and progress. How do you assess seriousness? A behavior, an appetite, activity, and the vital. I want to know from the mother, even for 2-3 weeks, but is he playful? Oh, doctor, he plays all the time. Seriousness is much less. Oh, the fever is not much, but I don't like his behavior. He is just sulking, he is lying down. He never did this before. Oh, there's something much more that I may not be easily overlooking, and I must look at what it is. And therefore, this is very, very important to make a first-hand impression, whether I have time on hand to make observations or to ask for tests, or I need to be in a hurry to get on to that. And then the progress. What has happened in the last 2-3 weeks? Oh, doctor, he is deteriorating. On the other hand, no, he is a little better. So if he is a little better, then I can wait on him. I think the first decision is how urgent it is for me to push myself into a hurried decision. Then, of course, I look at very carefully all these things. Each one has an important pallor. I'm sure the best way to look for pallor is your palm and not anywhere else. You may be fooled by the conjunctiva with conjunctivitis. The face often looks pale. Don't you have mothers who say, who come with one day of fever, doctor, he looks half. Not half by weight or height or anything. It's the mother's perception that he's down. Look for pallor, look for fatigue. We have already said that that certainly indicates something seriously going on and needs an answer. In other words, such points will easily focus on a pattern of investigation that you would order. And bony tenderness, lymph nodes of course, stomatitis, conjunctivitis, all these may be subtle findings of great relevance. You are all aware today that a disease like Kawasaki, for example, which is coming forth to be often seen now or reported, you will have such manifestations which otherwise may go easily unnoticed. Look at the small joints carefully. I'm sure the rheumatologist here might tell us that it's not easy to pick up such things. A bony swelling, of course. I recall a child was running 4 to 6 weeks of fever. Generally, antibiotics have been tried. The best way in our country is that you can prove anything even if it is not there by even test. And that's the testing a test. For example, if nothing is working, I say do a man too. Most of them will oblige by some positivity. And you say, look, I think it's the because it's positive. If you still want, you ask a radiologist to take a chest X-ray and he says query high alert. You forget the query, you stamp a high alert and you say must be TB. Okay, these are easily available in the market. And you need not go for it. To that extent, this was a child who was running 4-6 fever, and all that one has to do is to start the examination from a head to toe. And a head, when you palpated the skull, there was a swelling over the skull. And you knew this was a neuroblastoma there in the second place. The only clue in that child was a bony swelling. The point that I want to make is that such things are very, very easily missed. Some nail changes of acuteness, some hair changes like alopecia. You will see a child with a, say an SLE, for example, a systemic lupus erythematosus, who may have a nail changes, some alopecia. And I'm sure if a parent asks me, what's the cause of a hair loss? He says, no, no, that happens. And most of the parents believe when we say something even wrong. Because I'm sure we are not taught many of these things, and we are taught how to get over the situation by a very confident looking answer. And you know the definition of experience. Experience is defined by an ability to make the same mistake again and again, but with increasing confidence. So when I am an experienced person, parents don't ask me any questions because my confidence of making a mistake is at so high stake that I don't listen to anybody. If mantle is negative, TB occurs with mantle negative. If it's positive, who questions it? So any mantle is TB anyway. So that's where you look at. And I think some of these findings, for example, I recall a child who was running fever for 5 or 6 weeks. The only positive finding was a tachycardia out of proportion. And I think who has time to look at 1 minute pulse rate, respiratory rate, and tally it with the degree of fever and say that it is disproportionate tachycardia. All those are small little undergraduate things. You are at a postgraduate level experience. You don't count pulse rate for a minute. You probably even don't count it. Tachycardia might lead to a disease primarily right in the heart there. And I recall a child of a Kawasaki picked up only with a tachycardia. And he said, I don't know why there is a tachycardia. It's unexplained. Let's do an echo as well. and you pick up a coronary aneurysm there, and here the child is running fever for a few weeks, not knowing what's happening. You could have a subacute bacterial endocardite coming with just a tachycardia and nothing else seen clinically, and you wonder what it is. And therefore, such simple signs might have some clue. And of course, if you have a multi-organ involvement, then you know that it's much more a disseminated disease. The next one, please. Having said that, you have some special evidence on history and findings, which has no localization, which has no diagnosis. We hope that we have not iatrogenically complicated it. Let's see what kind of a laboratory test you would ask for. I'm sure when we don't understand anything, we look at the laboratory, as if laboratory understands everything. We say CBC, complete blood count, gives tremendous incomplete interpretation. Even when it is complete, the test is complete, the interpretation is yet to follow. And therefore, the provisional diagnosis is a must. I think I look at the test without a provisional diagnosis as thoroughly useless. And when a clinician says, I think we don't know, no, let's do a routine test. What is routine? There is nothing like routine. You don't ask for a stool test when you have a constipation. Okay, I'm sure a gastroenterologist would say that even that may be required sometimes, that you give an enema and examine a stool just because it's constipation doesn't mean you don't have an intestinal problem. But what I mean is that you have to have a provisional diagnosis. And if you don't have a provisional diagnosis, then it's like going to the police station and tell the inspector, catch a thief. Okay, he says, okay, I'll catch a thief. So he catches a thief and gets you in front of you. And he says, now here is a thief. He said, wait for a minute, I'll go home and find out what I have lost. And then I come out and say, oh, I've lost my pen. Oh, this is the thief. So how can that work? When you have a laboratory test which is positive, and you go back and say, ah, there it is. I think that does not work. That may be a thief, and you may have lost a pen, but your pen is not with that thief. So you won't get your pen anyway. And I think a provisional diagnosis is a must. Then when you get a CBC, you get a neutrophilic leukocytosis. But I started an antibiotic because I know you would certainly fire me if I did it without a diagnosis. But when I had 4 days of fever and a neutrophilic leukocytosis, I think, sir, it's a bacterial infection. Neutrophilic leukocytosis is an acute reaction, which could be seen even in acute viral infection. It could be seen in acute inflammatory conditions. There is no need to rush in unless you look at many other things. If you had a child with, say, a rheumatological disorder, I'm sure the rheumatologist will say with us that neutrophilic leukocytosis with thrombocytosis is his domain, and he doesn't give an antibiotic. You may have therefore to look at thrombocytosis, thrombocytopenia, and of course the rest of the indices, hemoglobin, ESR, etc. And a complete blood count is not possible to be interpreted unless you take care of eosinophils, for example, eosinopenia, indicating an acute insult to the bone marrow like an acute infection, and eosinophilia, indicating often a parasitic infection. But to us, if normals are up to 4%, 5% is diethyl carmarthenone, heterozyme for 3 weeks. Why? Because that 5 comes red, underlined. In fact, instead of underlining, you should say heterozyme. Eosinophil sounds heterozyme, more than 5%. It almost amounts to that. And therefore, all these investigations may have to be done. Blood culture. I think if you want to do a blood culture, you have to plan it before you give an antibiotic. And therefore, routine could be that if you have fever for 4 days, before it gets prolonged, if you should plan a CBC with a blood culture if you are thinking of typhoid. I'm sure today, culturing salmonella is so easy in a laboratory, but not after you have been intervened with all that. HDPC might form a few at times, because you have a malaria with us, a leptospira, a typhoid, fever, and so on. And they may also demonstrate that there's a liver involvement as well, in the form of maybe a mild lysin enzyme. A chest x-ray is very dubious. If you have a prolonged fever for 4 weeks, and chest x-ray shows some query lesion, I think a CT scan is necessary. I personally feel that chest x-ray has a great limitation in diagnosing a given condition. If you have a pneumonia, a clinician also should be able to find out. If you have a pleural effusion, a cavity, I think a clinician is also able to find out. What clinician cannot find out is a small lymph node there, which also an x-ray test often misguides. And if somebody says, I think you have picked up a lymph node there, I would even go to an extent of doing a CT scan if possible. And it's not rare to find various differences in the findings which otherwise would have gone really haywire. Abdominal sonography is not a bad idea for a prolonged fever. You might pick up some important clues. But with every modern technique, I think the responsibility of a clinician is so high that I'm sure in this city you must have seen an abdominal ultrasound done for a, say, a routine abdominal pain. And the sonologist says there are a few mesenteric lymph nodes, and there is also ascites. I'm sure our gastroenterologist will say that the fluid is there even in normal abdomen, and lymph nodes are also there in normal abdomen. A better the sonographic machine, the experience the sonographer, more the lymph nodes and more the fluid. Therefore, I wonder whether sometimes you must have a very ordinary sonography reporting a lymph node, so that you will report only pathological lymph nodes. It is very, very difficult to define when those lymph nodes come in as a cause of abdominal pain, whether they are pathological or so. And more often than not, they are not pathological. Therefore, we need to look at all these with great suspicion. Point is that if your clinical impression is quite different than a laboratory impression, believe in yourself and not anybody else. And therefore, say that, no, I think let me look at how to interpret that lab test. A bone marrow might be a need, more so if you are going to use some funny, irrational treatment like steroids. Many clinicians must have given cure to patients with steroids without knowing what they cured them for. But few of them must have landed up in trouble which nobody can solve them. And I don't think any child of yours should get steroids at all, even if you at the end of the story for 4 weeks feel that, oh, I think this is an immune-mediated disorder. If I give steroids, the fever will come down quickly. I would not spare a bone marrow on him because I don't want to miss a leukemia at all. If you miss a leukemia under some guise of, say, an inflammatory disorder being treated with steroids, I think you might land up with a very difficult leukemia, unsavorable to a patient. And therefore, that may be. If you have a lymph node, it may be a good idea to do a biopsy. I do not consider FNAC if I don't have any clue at all to a diagnosis. But if I have a setting of a tuberculous lymph node there, clinical setting of TB, a supportive evidence of TB, I think only FNAC may be enough. But I have no clue whatsoever, and you give a small piece of some kind and expect the pathologist to make a lot out of it, I think it's better the whole gland is given to him. Because many times out of the whole gland also, the report that you must have seen commonly is non-specific inflammation. I said that is the only thing I didn't want from you, because I have been non-specific. Try to be specific. That would be so. And then a specific serology. I think serology and PCR have caused more trouble than usefulness. I'm sure every science has advanced, and as we advance, we know their limitations. Today, serology, I'm told IgM means recent infection. But how recent we turn now? Some of the infections stay with IgM even for months, occasionally even for a year. That means when I came last forum here and today, I told my friend here this morning, I just came recently, which means last year, IgM positive. Okay. It means very little. And therefore, I think the serology has its own problems. When it comes to Vidal, and I'm sure yesterday I saw the program, ASO. I think if your ASO is high, you are a true Indian, that's all. You don't have a romantic feeling. If you have a Vidal positive, yes, you are again true to your nation. So, I think nothing more than that, not that you should not use it. And the worst to follow is serology of TB. I think that should be done in the sea. There's no other place. Because that's useless. You don't know what antigen, you don't know what specificity, what sensitivity, you don't know IgM, IgN, nothing you know. And people are happy calling TB antibody positive. Mycobacteria are also typical many. In that antigens are far many more. And the lab doesn't tell us anything except saying TB antibody positive. It has no meaning at all. I strongly urge you not to ask for TB antibody at all. And ban the test. There is no second opinion on that. Well, it has its own maybe a possibility. As we understand more a specific antigen antibody, it may be of use. As of now, ban the test. PCR has done wonderful harm as well. When PCR came in the city, I started seeing PCR TB positive for those who had never TB. And I didn't know it was that sensitive. that even a neighbor's TV can be picked up by what I mean is that don't lie. Because I'm exaggerating to make a point. Don't take all that. Don't quote me to say a test for neighbor's TV is a. What I mean is that PCR is a very, very strong technical test. And those who understand immunology have told me that the technique is so difficult. Each time there are technical advances occurring, many of the laboratories do an obsolete technique, and therefore it is not rare to see a child being referred to me for an MDR TV because his PCR is MDR. He's all right. He will never sick only. He has had one course of anti-TB drugs, second line, there is no third line now. So they said, ask him what to do. When I don't understand what to do, I know only one thing that always helps, and that means don't do anything. Mostly it works. So PCR also has a thing. I'm not against PCR. It's an advance. But we need to know. What I mean is that when you choose to refer a patient to a consultant, you choose a consultant by his credibility or whatever. But when you choose a test, you just send it to a lab nearby. You don't see the credibility of the test kit. You don't ask any questions. And I think that is wrong. A good scientific laboratory pathologist should vouch to say, this is a test that I'm not very comfortable with. And I've had an occasional immunologist in the city of Mumbai who said that, I will tell you PCR is positive, but don't think he has TB. I said, I'm happy. Because he knows that his test may have limitations both, false positive and negative. And I'm sure what I'm trying to convey is that don't depend on any investigation alone unless you have a clinical strong situation. Rarely you have a persistence of fever in spite of correct diagnosis and treatment. And this is not rare. I see a child of pneumonia who has a correct diagnosis, correct treatment, but he is not responding. Surely he has a complications like a collection of pus, or he has a general complications like an immune reaction. For example, you must have seen a patient with, say, a dengue, a simple viral infection, but if he has a secondary dengue and immune response, well, he continues to do that. Haven't you seen a TBM where a good anti-TB drug, the moment you go off steroid, he may start coming out with symptoms again, because they are not a failure of drugs, but they are failure of an immune system. You need steroids to continue. So there may be immune reaction. There may be unfavorable host condition. I have a damaged lung, and a damaged lung is not infected. How will I get well quickly? I need to give longer treatment. I may need to have a good drainage. So all that might. For example, a bronchiectasis. Unless I have a good postural drainage and a good chest physiotherapy, my antibiotic alone does not work, and the patient continues to have fever. And what does the clinician do? Change antibiotics, till the parent change the doctor. And therefore, a chest PT, etc. would help. Malformation. I have some cyst adenomatoid malformation there, or a sequestered lung there. It is getting infected again and again. Well, the drug may not be responsible for a failure. You may have something more to do. Drug resistance. I still feel in clinical practice, in community practice, drug resistance is rare. Drug resistance is only in an ICU setting, nosocomial infection, which means thanks to iatrogenic situation. In community practice, nobody should consider drug resistance till proved otherwise. I'm aware of MDR typhoid, I'm aware of malaria with resistance, but I still would urge that resistance is rare. And let's not blame a drug for it's not acting. Let's blame ourselves for choosing the wrong drug for whatever reason. And lastly, the drug resistance is easy to make up. If you have a malaria which is resistant to chloroquine, quinine, whatever, I think it should be easy to pick up. A drug-resistant infection is easy to make up, difficult to treat. Drug-sensitive infection may be difficult to make up, easy to treat. You have in clinical practice a combination of difficult to make up and still difficult to treat. That is not common. And therefore, drug resistance is not a very common situation. There is a variable response. Not every child of TB is rosebrand in 1 week or 2 weeks. And if a general condition is improving, we'll not worry about it and continue the drug the same way. There is, of course, a fictitious fever and finally drug fever. In my practice, when I see a prolonged fever after every trial has been given, I choose to stop the drug for two reasons. And I tell the parents, one of the two things will happen. He will be alright forever. whether drug fever or no drug fever, but I know stopping drug was an answer. Or he would surface out something that I can make up. And the plea is that if two antibiotics have failed, a third antibiotic never works. And you should stop using antibiotics and change your diagnosis. The last point, the therapeutic dilemma. You have to assess seriousness of risk of waiting. And I made this clear in the beginning that let us assess the risk of waiting. And it's not at all bad. I haven't lost the patient, nor his faith. When I wrote down on a piece of paper that 4 days of fever, no clinical clue, no evidence of meningitis, pneumonia, sepsis, diphtheria, surgical abdomen, advised to wait with paracetamol and report in 2 days. I think clarity and a reasonable confidence that there is no risk of waiting would not make you lose a patient nor his faith. But in a hurry, if we do something, we might lose a patient or his faith. And I think, of course, when you get senior and you tell a parent that you don't know the diagnosis, they feel you are not only good but you are modest. That you can say you don't know. That's an additional advantage you will start gaining when you become senior. That when I say no, I don't know, they feel I am modest. How can I say you don't know? Sir, you must be knowing. So take that advantage. Those who are senior must take the advantage of being modest. It helps. It is also true. Avoid drugs that would hamper correct interpretation of laboratory tests. If you are anticipating an infection and a blood culture or a urine culture, don't be in a hurry to give an antibiotic. You will miss it and make it prolonged. Withdraw drugs and evaluate freshly if you don't understand anything what's happening. If two sets of antibiotics have failed, new antibiotic is unlikely to act. And lastly, drug resistance should not be presumed. And friends, I just said that prolonged fever is often caused by us. And I thought I would address the issue of how to avoid prolonged fever. And then when you face it, if you don't understand what to do, do nothing. That's the best you can do. And then plan afresh. Thank you very much.